Here we go. Hello, everybody, and welcome to, I believe it is the seventh episode of the 17 Minutes of Science, the Quarantine Chronicles that we've been enjoying putting out there for you guys. And also, happy Cinco de Mayo. I happened to check the calendar today, even though one day bleeds right into the next, and realized that it was a day worth celebrating. My name is Sarah Cheeseman. I am a technical solutions scientist at Invivo Biosystems. And thank you again for coming by to hear about today, a really cool topic. Kids who code, inspiring the next generation of coders. And our guest is the wonderful Dr. Lan Gua. And Lan is a data scientist at Invivo Biosystems, and she applies machine learning methods to the analysis and modeling of genetic variants, complex phenotypes, and transcriptome data. That's a mouthful. Using organisms. So in short, she is a coding and computing whiz. And we're lucky to have her. So before we get going with Lan, feel free to drop us questions over Facebook as always, or say hello so we know you're there. And Lan, can you give us a quick 30-second intro about your background?
Thank you, Sarah, for that nice introduction. I think you cover pretty much everything and much more. I think, I'll just start with the part that we didn't cover, which is my academic background. So I'm actually trained as a neuroscientist. I did a PhD in neurophysiology, and then I did postdoc in systems neuroscience, working in basically studying neurocircuit function in rodent models. So mainly working in, in my PhD, I worked in the septum hippocampus circuit, and in my postdoc, I worked in auditory circuit of rodents, trying to understand how cells and different brain regions interact to produce complex behavior, like decision making. So that was that. But when I was doing my neuroscience research, I kind of gravitate towards the more computational and analytic side of things, away from the experimental side, the wet lab side of things. I decided I really am just interested in finding patterns and meaning from data, not so much doing hands-on experiments. So I taught myself to code in Python and shell script, and just slowly transition into a data science role. And luckily I found a job at Invivo, which had been worked out great for me and really let me develop that side of my skills. Yeah.
Well, we're lucky to have you. And it sounds like your path was made to lead you in this direction. But interesting that you recognized after all those years that you really preferred the computational side and less so the lab side. Because some people feel the opposite way.
That's true. I think I knew from the beginning. I just didn't really know. I didn't see my straight path towards what I wanted to do. So it kind of took a more circuitous path for me, a bunch of trial and error to get there.
We should do a 17 minutes of science on circuitous paths sometime. Good story, right? Everyone's got one.
Yeah.
So when you did end up kind of refocusing on the area that you're in now, in the more machine learning, artificial intelligence space, Was it during your postdoc that you really sort of solidified those ideas?
Yes, it is. So I did two postdocs. One was at Stanford and one was at the University of Oregon. And during Stanford time, I really was doing a lot of wet lab stuff, and I realized I really didn't like it that much. And at that time, Stanford's famous for its computer science education. So I went and took a bunch of classes. I literally just went and sit in some undergrad classes and some graduate level classes without having to pay tuition, which is great. So that's how I learned to code in Python, and I learned a little bit of C++ and data structures and stuff like that. And then I realized I really get it, and it's really kind of playing to my strengths. I kind of got addicted to coding. And then I found a new faculty at the UO, Santiago. His lab was really very, how do you call it? Maybe it's because his background is in electrical engineering. So his lab has kind of like a futuristic feel to me, in that a lot of the stuff in it is automatic.
So that's so interesting.
Yeah, we will be writing programs in Python to control an Arduino, which controls an open chamber type box to train our mice to do behavior tests. So that is like, it's leaps and bounds better than doing it manually, you know, opening the doors and putting the lights yourself. So it really attracted me. So I applied and got accepted into his lab as a postdoc. And that's really, I learned a lot of coding and Python in like the scientific application in that lab.
And there's more and more of that kind of skill set required in the space now to handle these huge volumes of data too. So interesting.
Yeah, exactly. When we were doing these electro recording from the brain, and then later we switched to the silicon probes. And nowadays the probe up to like 100 contact size. So you can theoretically record from thousands of cells at once in the brain. So you have a ton of data.
Yeah. When you were a postdoc, I know you volunteered with Gigabit City. And can you tell us a bit more about what the Mozilla Gigabit City is?
Yeah, so that was, I believe, in 2017, Eugene was awarded a grant by the Mozilla Foundation to develop projects that are more grassroots, but that really benefit the community, utilizing the high-speed internet network that they're starting to build downtown, the fiber network. So Mozilla gives out these funds for small projects that's focused on education and benefiting the community with the new high-speed internet technology. So this one in particular was about teaching kids to code and interact with programs and robots. So we went to elementary school. We taught fourth graders, like a little 1 month curriculum. Maybe it's 2 months. About each week we go and we teach them a little bit about like basic concepts of computing, robots, how to write a program.
Was that a pretty novel experience for most of those kids?
Yeah, I think so. Well, some of the kids, it kind of varies, right? So I was assigned to Irvine Elementary up on Northwest Expressway on the west side of town. And I think a lot of those kids, they didn't have things at home that exposed them to, you know, computers. They might have iPads and stuff like that, but nothing like building robot sets. But some other, you know, some kids will have exposure, and I did have a couple kids in my classroom that says, "Oh, my dad does this," or something like that. You know?
So was it a big challenge to design a curriculum that could be digested by the 9 and 10 year old set? Oh,
yeah. Well, it was actually fortunately, people before us have developed the curriculum. We were thinking we have to do a lot of work in, like, you know, making it kid approachable, but the curriculum was already in place and it's a pretty good one. So they have developed it, worked on it, maybe like even iteratively with kids and teacher before our year. I think it was 1 year before that. And then we just had to think about how to deliver it and how to organize the whole classroom activity.
So was that hard, or was that fun, or was
it the difficult part? Yeah, because the each room there's like 20 10-year-old kids, and they were pretty rowdy.
Yeah, I was gonna say pretty noisy.
They were pretty noisy. Yeah. Well, I work with two teachers, or fourth grader teachers, and they have different kind of approach and level of control over their room. So yeah, it's interesting to observe like how the teachers and the kids interact and how the kids themselves form little groups. We divide them into little groups to work on little sub projects. And it's very interesting for me to see I didn't have a kid at that time. Now I have a 2-year-old. But it's kind of a primer for me.
Someday you will have a fourth grader. A rowdy fourth grader.
Yeah, they're wonderful kids. They really are. And they just get a little very hyper excited at times.
Well, I imagine that doing activities like that is so out of the ordinary that it generates itself.
Yeah, they were super excited. So we had these gigabit robots that were designed by Nicole, a local programmer here in Eugene, and she designed these. So Lego have this 3D building program you could use to design your build, and then she like draws a blueprint and we assemble the blocks before we give it to the students, and it has controllers and it has sensors. So then we assemble the bots and then we bring it to the classroom and they immediately go crazy and wouldn't listen to anything because they were so like, they just want to explore the robot. Yeah.
That's cool. Yeah. And did you feel like you were maybe able to connect with the little girls more, being that you're a woman in the machine?
I was hoping to, but you know, I did find, interestingly, in both classes, I feel personally that the girls were less interested in it than the boys. I was hoping to, you know, because they intentionally recruited women coders so that it would be more approachable for the fifth grader girls. But actually the girls were a little bit more shy and appear to be less interested in the robots and the concepts.
I wonder if that has something to do with with Lego too, is less interested in that too as they step through their adolescence, typically.
Maybe. But I wonder how much of it is like kind of like a stereotyping. Maybe the teacher, the school, or our whole education system that just didn't encourage girls to do that. I don't know. And I try to, if I ask a question and the girls and the boys raise their hands, I would try to pick the girls to answer it, because they just raise their hand far less often than the boys. So it was like, oh, a girl wants to answer this question.
Yeah, the socialization piece. That's interesting. Because they start to emerge so early. Yeah.
You also don't want to force it on them, right? If they're really not into it, you can't say that this is the thing you need to do now.
Right, that's fair. That's totally fair. Well, just the act of you showing up as a woman in the field, even if not all the girls, they could say anything, I'm sure that they will not forget that, because that may look different than what they've seen before.
Yeah, they were really sweet. They gave me a very nice card at the end. Everyone signed it.
So your efforts were rewarded. I note also that you've done other volunteer work with the DataKind, DataCore Community Health Worker Impact Program. Can you tell us a little bit more about that and about Medic Mobile?
So that DataKind is a nonprofit organization based on in New York, I think, and they have chapters all over the world. They have in Singapore, in London, in Africa, all over the world. So their mission is to use data science and machine learning to do social good. So they really are very driven to like use modern technology to benefit communities around the world. I thought their mission was very worthwhile effort, and so I also wanted to meet more people that are like-minded, so I applied to be a volunteer data expert there last year. So I interviewed and then got selected for one of the projects. I think they usually have a lot of applications and they interview a whole lot of people, so I feel pretty lucky to be selected.
Yeah, that's really cool. And what's the project you've been working on?
So this project we've been working on is part of their Data Corps suite of projects. And this one was working with data from Kenya, and specifically community health worker data. So these people in Africa and many lesser developed parts of the world, I think there's a big issue of people getting access to healthcare, either because they live too far from the healthcare facility and there's not that many of these facilities, or it's because like there are not that many trained healthcare professionals. So they develop another model. So they recruit people from the community. These are community members. They take them in. They train them in basic like medical skills and diagnostic skills, and then they let them go back into their community. So they actually would be able to bring the healthcare to the people instead of the people having to come to the healthcare, to the doctor's office. So this is great, and it really has been proven to benefit the community immensely in like providing enough timely healthcare and consultation. So it's been shown to reduce the motility rate in pregnant women and in newborn kids especially. Our project is working with newborn babies that's younger than 30 days. We got the records from the healthcare worker. So Medic Mobile is a partner of DataKind, and they are the ones that made these mobile apps for use in by the CHW with community health workers, CHW. So they enter in the app when they go door to door. They would enter the patient's basic information, the basic household demographic information, and then they usually do a visit to pregnant women, maybe like 5 to 9 visits during the pregnancy, and they would enter the information. Is there any danger sign to the mom? What's the household situation? Do they have clean water? Do they have a mosquito net? Stuff like that. And then they visit back when the baby's born. They also record whether the mom delivered in a facility or at home. And then after the baby's born, they give immunization and they record any danger sign in the newborn. Yeah.
So it's a lot of data.
Yeah, it's a lot of data, and we don't have access to that much data. We only have one county in Kenya, but still an over a couple months duration, but it's still data to play with. And our model was, the goal was to predict whether a newborn is more likely to develop a danger sign based on all the features we can gather. Yeah.
Wow. That must be incredibly gratifying to be able to do a project like that. So far away, that's facilitated by all this incredible power.
Kind of unreal when I think about it. And I'm looking at data actually from Africa, from real people.
Yeah, and impacting their lives. It's remarkable. Wow.
That's the hope. I'm hoping this could help in some way, if it could help in, you know, one of those thing about maybe the app design or like data quality or what kind of data they need to gather in the future. Even just a little bit, it is good, you know. I don't think that this is gonna be like the end result is gonna be the thing that ends the motility of newborns, but I mean, it's a little step towards that direction.
That's all we're doing right now today, putting one step foot in front of the other. Our timer went off. Lon, you're amazing. I love learning from you when we get a chance to talk like this, and especially because we haven't had a chance to see each other in person. So this has been a real treat. And thank you for taking the time.
Yeah, nice talking to you too.
And I want to thank everybody who tuned in to hear what Lon is up to and all the powerful work that volunteerism is happening around the globe right now. So thank you for that. And we will look forward to seeing you next week with a new episode. And until then, be safe.
Stay safe.
Take care. Bye, Lon.
Bye-bye.